This talk today is about a notion that I have developed in the previous years and inspired by the notion by the area of network science. It's a notion of self-modeling network, and it has turned out to give a number of interesting application possibilities, and especially to get adaptive models, adaptive causal models. And that's what I will focus on in this lecture. So these are some references that you can find. I have a YouTube channel on self-modeling networks. You can just search for this term, because the term is not so often used. You can find it immediately, probably. I have a ResearchGate site with most of my publications, and also this talk is also there with slides, and I will also place the video there probably. Is there, by the way, is there at the moment the recording, is it on, or should I put it on myself?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay, thanks. So these are some, and maybe also one thing, there is a summer school where I give a short version of my master course with some similar topics as in this talk, but then more extensively. So this is the overview of the talk. I will discuss a little bit about causal modeling in its traditional appearance, and also with its limitations, especially for dynamics and adaptivity. And then I will jump to the idea of network science that has generated a number of new elements in the spectrum, and especially like the characteristics of networks that you can use to model dynamic networks and adaptive networks. These, among these characteristics, there are the normal things that you always have in a network, but also the dynamic things like timing. I will discuss dynamics within a network, and also dynamics of a network, which are two distinguished sides. In the latter case, we have adaptive network structure characteristics. And then I will discuss the idea of self-modeling network, which gives the opportunity to model adaptive network in an easy way. And then I will discuss the how you can add it, and then that brings causal modeling to a more wide applicability. So causal modeling is a very long-standing tradition in AI, and it is a very transparent and declarative form of modeling, which is quite useful in principle to use it. And so it's also, causality is in most scientific disciplines, that's a very central concept. Mostly in literature, it's just discussed how certain states may influence other states and how they have some causal relation. So it's very unifiable concepts that makes it possible to unify many disciplines. So therefore, the expectation should be that it is very useful for many disciplines. But there are unfortunately limitations, especially the dynamics of causation. How long does it take when something causes something else? There is the limitation in adaptivity of the causal relations, because in practical applications, usually causal relations can change over time, and that's not in a traditional causal modeling approaches, that's not covered. And so that's just an issue. Now, for the talk of today, I can discuss some recent developments from network science that offer solutions to these relations, so that we can say solve that problem in a sense. So network science is a new area of recent years. That's the At least it is now called like that, but it has roots already going back to the 1930s and 1950s from different sciences, different disciplines. And of course, more recently from computer science, we also have internet and social media networks that has that have contributed to this area, to the development of this area. So let's just consider some basic concepts of network science, and in particular of the network-oriented modeling approach that I've developed over the last 5 to 10 years. The basic characteristics of what I call a temporal causal network, so I add the notion of temporality to a causal network. That means that there is just a temporal dimension, which is labeled with real numbers as time points. And then it's a network is described by the connectivity, which is rather standard in network science. You have connection weights for connections, for example, that are real numbers. And then there is a form of aggregation needed, because you can have multiple connections to one other node. And then the question arises, how should you combine these multiple effects of these other nodes? So that's what aggregation is about. All networks have to deal with that if you want to do some simulation with them, for example, because you have to know what the different inputs for a given node have, how they combine. So that's, you need some form of combination. And for the dynamic aspect, you also need a form of timing. And for the timing, we need speed factors for if each state. I call nodes also states because they are also at the same time state variables, because they have very variable levels, variable activation levels over time. So these are just the basic characteristics of a temporal causal network structure. These things define the network fully. Let's just focus still a little bit on this notion of aggregation. Pearl, in his famous book on causality, notes already a kind of issue that usually in causal models, you just draw pictures with nodes and arrows. But you forget to indicate the functions that make it work in the sense of how the influences are combined. So that he already points at that. So therefore, he already was aware of that in the usual presentation of causal models, there was a serious underspecification actually of the network. So therefore, it has to be stressed that these functions are also very important. And for the timing, different processes, if you make applications, different processes often have different speeds. Even the granularity by which you model processes can be different. So maybe you make big steps in one node, and in another node you make small steps. So therefore, you can have different speeds and different timescales. That's the normal situation. And if you don't differentiate the timing for different nodes, that implies, in fact, a kind of incorrect form of synchrony. In real situations, there is often not such a synchrony. So speed factors, they enable you to get rid of that artificial type of synchrony. So for the aggregation in our approach, we have a combination function library which has at the moment around 40 functions. And you can also compose functions by the normal mathematical function composition operation. So you can make infinite number of functions out of this library. So these are some standard forms that are often used. For example, we have minimum and maximum functions that are often used in fuzzy modeling. Mm-hmm. We have scaled sum functions that are often used in social network models. There is a similar function, a geometric mean function that has a similarity to that scaled sum, but then from the multiplication. And there is the Euclidean combination function, which can be used, for example, for NS2 to combine things by a kind of vector addition. So if you have really independent things, you could say that the vector addition is a good way of adding things. And there is, of course, also there are the logistic sum functions that are also often used in artificial neural networks, like these, for example. But these are just a few of the at the moment around 40 functions, and you can also add functions very easily. Writing a new function is in the software environment is just a matter of 5 or 10 minutes. So, sorry, these are the basic elements of a network specification. These characteristics. And we can just specify them in some table format, and we call it role matrices. I will explain the role in a minute. They define the network structure. And now, of course, you want to simulate things, and you want to use this modeling format to simulate dynamic processes and even adaptive processes. So how do we do that? Well, this is a function. A difference equation based on these characteristics. For example, you see the omegas here, you see the combination function there, you see the speed factor there, and each in this calculation, each of these have a different role. It matters a lot whether the number here is used for at that place, or you would use it at this place, for example. So that's the idea of roles. They have different roles in the whole calculation, because this is the difference equation that is used for the calculation also in the software environment. And they are just given, and it's standard. It's a kind of canonical way to put these numbers, from the tables, in some format that can be simulated. So that's the basic part. For modeling, you don't need to see this even. You don't need to make this at least, because it's given. You can just concentrate on designing these role matrices to specify these things. That's all. So you can consider these things, all of these numbers, they have their impact on state Y. Y is just any node of the network, and all of these numbers have impact, but from different roles. And sometimes I call that they are the contextual causal impacts, because it's not only that these axes are the nodes that affect Y, they are, but also these things have their impact too. So that's a kind of shift of conceptualization that you say, well, there are more causal impacts. That's also in general in the case. If you talk about causal pathways, for example, in some scientific discipline, that they often talk about such things, then the causal pathways depend on the contextual situation in the world. Even in the case of physics, you cannot apply laws of physics if you don't take into account what is in the world. If you have objects that stand in the way, you can never have any physical law working, because the object may just obstruct it. So that's the contextual side. And I also now consider that as causal impacts, but from a different role. So this equation can also be written in a differential equation format like this. So this is how network structure characteristics entail network dynamics. And as I already said, they are hidden in the software environment. And if you want to analyze a model to determine what is the case for an equilibrium of the model, then you can just find it here easily, because in an equilibrium, these two things are in balance. They are the same, because then there is no difference here anymore. So then this is the equation for the equilibrium. I will come back to that later. So let's now consider how the dynamics can work based on such a network structure. Then the dynamics is working like like this.
Aww.
The dynamics within a network. That's related to the network structure, because the network structure is the only thing that determines the dynamics. So then you can have an interesting challenge. How does that structure actually relate to this emerging network behavior within the network? So within the network means that the nodes change, but the network structure remains the same. So that's the structures described by these characteristics. And then a challenge is to find out how properties of these characteristics imply properties of the emerging behavior. And these characteristics represent what I just mentioned also as the contextual causal pathways, in addition to the base causal pathways represented by the nodes. So equilibria may emerge, for example, in a social setting, social contagion setting, when people have different opinions. Will a group come to the same opinion by social contagion? Will the states have a common value? These are just relevant questions about certain types of applications. But you can also, if it's not always, under what conditions on the structure will this happen? These are things that can play a role in many types of applications. And then you can check what are equilibrium states for the network, for example, but you can also have limit cycles or chaotic behavior. And again, that the equilibrium criterion is very useful here. And in my 2020 book that was in the references, there are chapters 11 and 12, where I have a number of theorems of this type, that certain types of connectivity and aggregation lead to certain types of equilibria. So let's just consider an example for dynamics within a network. And this is social contagion for a flock of sheep, this one. You can wonder, will all of them go in the same direction? It's like, will they get the same opinion after some time? And well, then the issue is, it just depends on the structure of the network. And then the question in addition can be, how exactly do they depend on the structure of the network? So in this case, we see here something that is called nowadays an influencer. So this sheep here seems to be an influencer, a big influencer. Let's call that sheep Boris. So then there are maybe questions for the sheep, like existential questions, like to be or not to be. And then they can just follow this Boris, this influencer. They don't need to think anymore. They can just follow the Boris here. But this example can also be translated to the human society. And then, for example, in the UK, lately, there was the big question to Brexit or not to Brexit. And indeed, there was also a kind of Boris figure there who has acted to lead the people to the right decision in his case. So that's just an example. This is also an example how you can see that in this modeling format is just a kind of unifying structure that can be applied in different types of context. So this is another example. This is another flock of sheep. You see that in this case, the sheep some new other structure has emerged from the sheep. There's not just one influencer anymore. In fact, they are all influencers now, because they influence each other in a kind of cyclic structure. So that shows already an example of an adaptive network, a network that adapts its structure over time. And in this case, it gets a cyclic connectivity structure. And it turns out that it ends up in a kind of limit cycle behavior, approximately, that the behavior is all the time the same. They're running around like this. So that's just another illustration of how how structures of networks can look like, but it's also an illustration of how that can change over time, but because it was not before, of course, because the car just was arriving, I suppose. So therefore, we now make the step to dynamics of a network, and that's just what you call an adaptive network or an adaptive network model. Then you have a network structure characteristics that change over time, at least some of them. And there are, again, we have three types of them. We have connectivity, we have aggregation and timing. Remember the three main concepts. Then you can have adaptation for each of them. Well, connectivity adaptation is for many of you very familiar, I think. That means that you change connection weights in many neural networks. There are many applications of neural networks to machine learning, to deep learning. And then usually the connection weights are changed over time by the learning mechanism. So this is very, very well known, but it's not the only thing. There are also other cases. You can have changing aggregation, like changing combination functions, for example, by changing their parameters, like in the logistic combination function, you can change the excitability threshold, which makes it more easy or less easy to get activated. So these are also quite well-known forms of adaptation, but not in the machine learning area so much, but in the application areas. I will just push that for the area of neuroscience, for example. And of course, there is the possibility to change the timing to accelerate or decelerate the change speed. And that's also a very useful type of adaptation. So what do we see here? So this is to find a way to model adaptive network easily. You can see here a picture that, by the way, I took from one of my son's Instagram sites that address streetwear as fashion trend. And what you see here, there is a big picture. This one, the base picture. And then there is here a picture in the picture. So I call this metaphor that I use the picture-in-picture metaphor, which in some sense reflects, shows the whole. This is a kind of self model for the whole picture. That's what I call it, a self model. And this means that this is showing the whole picture, actually. Well, this is not a perfect example because the similarity is only to a certain extent. So therefore, this is not the ideal example. Let's just leave it behind. Now, let's look at this example. This is an example where this looks very much more the same as the real picture, but there is another, so this can be also called the self model here, but there is a kind of other issue here, because from what part of the picture is this a self model? In the original picture, this part is not there anymore because it's covered. So that's also not a perfect example, but it still gives a little bit the idea. So then we can look at another example, this one. This looks already a bit better. So this is a self-model. I call it now a first-order self-model. That will become clear soon why. So you see that there is this picture is indeed reflected well there. But now there is another problem, because this is not a self-model of the whole picture, because now as soon as this self-model is added, there are, for example, two faces, and the whole picture has two faces, and this is not a cell model with two faces. So then you are pressed to continue like this. And you have here, yeah, here we have something with two faces now, but now there are four faces in the meantime in the picture, and there are not four faces in the cell model here. This is what we call a second order cell model. Well, the problem here is that if you want to have a really sincere modeling, self-model, then you have to continue forever. So that's what you call infinite regress. So that's a limitation of this whole concept. This is also an example. This is already from 1904. Droste is a famous Dutch brand for chocolate and cacao. And they invented this type of presentation of their product. And then you see here the same picture is in the picture, and then the same picture is there again, and so on and so on. So that's sometimes, this is called the Droste effect, this picture in picture ID. So this is another example. So let's have some reflection of this. There's also the infinite regress here. So what are takeaway points? Because we want to apply this ID as a metaphor to find the notion of self-modeling network, a network which contains some form of self-model. So that's what can we learn from this? Well, there are some issues to take care of. That's the faithfulness of the self-model. That is the, this one was not so good for that. It is the persistence of the base picture. So you should not lose things of the base picture. But this one is an example that does not fit well for that. And there is incompleteness for practical cases, that you should accept that the picture will always be, the cell model will always be incomplete, not a total picture, unless you have in practical, non-practical cases, you make mathematical constructions that are infinite, or you do some magical way of illusion. You can try it like that too. But for us, we are concentrating on the practical cases. So what is now a self-model? We can use that to get a uniform declarative network-oriented way to address adaptive networks. It can easily be iterated for higher order networks, adaptive networks. There is no procedural specification or programming code needed. And it covers adaptive dynamics, which otherwise is outside the context of network-oriented and causal modeling. So how do we do it? So this, just by adding a self-model to it, just adding the small picture, the subnetwork in this case with states representing network structure characteristics. We have these different forms of network structure characteristics. So we can have a self-model for connectivity, for aggregation, or for timing. Let me give an example. So these are network characteristics, for example. For those we want to have a self-model, we just add new states to the network, new nodes, the W for this one, T for that one, and H for that one. You can see that they are the self-model states, and they are actually a kind of representations of the parameters of your model by variables. Any adaptive model you have to use for any type, you have to use new variables. But in this case, the special thing is that these new variables are network concepts. So it's not just variables, they are just specific network concepts that we have. They are just nodes here, for example. Then the next step, of course, is that we need also some extra network structure for them to have them as a subnetwork. And that's how it goes like this. Suppose that we consider connections of this small base network. We add these new states, and they have then referencing relations to that, but this is not in the causal model, but just for the understanding of it. But then you have to make clear how they connect to it, to the rest of the network. And that's what I will show now. So you need incoming connections for the new self-model states that make them dynamics. And you have outgoing connections that get their effects implemented in the network. And you need aggregation to specify the type of adaptation. So that's a combination function, just one of the library, for example. And you have timing. the speed factors, then you get the idea of adaptation speed, learning rate. So a number of well-known things that are always needed when you need to specify an adaptive process, they are just available now in the standard concepts from network models. So let's consider briefly from some neuroscience literature. So this is about plasticity in strength of connections, but also intrinsic neural properties. So that's also, it's not only the connections. That's what from that literature can be learned. My perspective is that I'm interested in nature-based adaptation, those types of things that are discussed from empirical literature, not just artificial constructs in from a modeling perspective. And this is another one from that type of literature. Adaptation accelerates with increasing stimulus exposure. And also, high stress levels slow down or block adaptation. That is called metaplasticity. That's plasticity of the metaplasticity. I already mentioned that the construction of self-modeling can just be iterated easily because the self-modeling network is a network itself. And then you can just use that as a next base network to iterate the construction. So therefore, this metaplasticity is also easily doable. I will show examples in a short time. The Hebbian learning adaptation principle, for example, is often described like this. Neurons that fire together, wire together. There is this enhanced excitability adaptation principle from Chandra and Barkai that I already mentioned. So let me just show this one. So suppose we have this connection that we want to learn by Hebbian learning, the connection from X to Y. Then we add the self-model state for it, the W state for that one. And then we need to model that neurons that fire together, that condition. That means that you need to know that whether when these neurons fire together. So you need connections to that to get input. And then for the wiring together, you need to do something there, and then you have the connection downward so that in the processing of Y, this is actually used, this value for the connection weight. So that's how the principle works. And what we have here is now a building block. This is just a small network that can be used in any application of other networks, just as building block to build your adaptation into the network. So that's the connectivity self-model, W is a connectivity. So that's the aggregation, that's the connectivity. Now the aggregation, that's how you specify an adaptation principle. In this case, one of the functions in the library, there are multiple of them for Hebbian learning, but this is one function, the simplest one maybe, is to specify this. This goes like this. These neurons that fire together, they are specified by this product. So if both are, they are between 0 and 1, these values usually. So if both are high, then the product is high. And if one of them is not high, then the product is also not high. So that's, this is a kind of reflection of the idea neurons that fire together. Then they should wire together. That's that we added to the current value of the connection weight. And this is only for normalization in the 0-1 interval. So this formula is just a formula that can be used for Hebbian learning. And notice that this is not how often learning methods are described. This is just a function, a declarative mathematical function. By describing this function, you apply some form of adaptation. No algorithmic or program code like specifications are needed. So now also here we can ask whether how you can see what for a kind of analysis how the emerging network behavior looks like given the structure. Well, in this case, this is the equation. The W is equal to that part, and then you can just rewrite it a little bit like this, that you can express the W in terms of your the state activation levels in the equilibrium. And for example, then you can conclude that if the mu actually is a persistence factor, which is full persistence if it's one. If this is one with full persistence, then in equilibrium the W is one, at least they are not zero, or they are not zero, the V1 and V2. And if the mu is less than one, it's not possible to have value one. The value will in the equilibrium will always less than one of the connection weight. So these types of conclusions you can draw from such a mathematical analysis based on the same function that I just the same declarative function that I just have shown. So in my 2020 book, that's in the references, there are several types of Hebbian learning functions and derivations like this, what you can tell about equilibria in chapter 14 in this case. There is one example, maybe to have more time for other things, I will skip this. I also have a presentation in the technical session, and then I will discuss more the social network application. And that's, this will be part of that too, so I skip it now. I will focus now on the second order adaptation, the metaplasticity. Remember this one, the exposure accelerates adaptation speed principle. There is also a similar principle, exposure modulates persistence. And there is usually a kind of issue that an organism should often be stable to live well, but in some cases you need not to, you should not be stable, but you need plasticity to change, to adapt to circumstances. And that is something that is switching all the time. So that's the sometimes called the plasticity versus stability conundrum. For example, you may know this saying, old habits die hard. That refers to, in some cases, you need new habits, but you still have to get rid of your old habits. And that's exactly what is all this about, that it's good to have habits, that you have a stable situation for yourself, but in some cases, you may still need the plasticity. So then, therefore, such adaptation principles are needed. These are second order adaptation principles. And I already mentioned this one. I will illustrate them in a minute in an application example. For this second order principles, we need two levels. So this is still the base level where Hebbian learning takes place. This is the self model for that. Then we have a second order self model for the speed factor of this one. So therefore you can have this adaptive speed in this. So this is again a building block that can be easily used in applications for whenever you need it. So this is for exposure accelerates. And this is the acceleration itself. So these new states, they can have their own, this eight states, the second order self-model states, they can have just logistic or Euclidean combination functions. They don't need very special functions in general. Similar, you can do it for the persistence parameter of the Hebbian learning function. Then you have a state M here that represents the persistence of the learning that is represented by the W. So then you also have these different connections. Let me just finally go to the example to illustrate it. So suppose this is a base network. This is a base network for emotion regulation. You have a stressful stimulus. This is a sensor state. You sense the stressful stimulus. There is some stressful event, maybe recurring in your environment, and you make a representation in your brain, in your mental world, sensory representation for the stressful stimulus, and then it triggers an emotional reaction. That's a stressful response. That can be a kind of fear-like reaction. That's how they often call it in the literature. So that based on that, in relation to that response, you get also a stressful feeling. That's this one. And then you have internal regulation mechanisms that are able to a certain extent to regulate your emotion, and in this case, your stressful emotion. And for that, this state is used, the control state for this emotion. And that is for the stress regulation. And in this case, we also have a therapy state that tries to help you to improve your stress regulation. Because for many disorders, mental disorders, but also the physical like disorders, having long-term stress is not a healthy situation. Therefore, it may make sense to improve your stress regulation mechanisms. So this is the learned connection. Usually, if your stress regulation is poor, that means that the prefrontal cortex, where this represents part of the prefrontal cortex, is not activating so much. While this, which may represent the amygdala, for example, is high, then this still is low. That means that you want to strengthen this connection type because you want to, from this activation, you want to propagate it to the prefrontal cortex activation. So this is the main focus of the learning of emotion regulation. So that's the learned connection that we consider here. So let's see how we do it. Well, of course, then we need a W state for that, the connection from this one to that one. And this is then the self-model state indeed. And then this part is just the self-model for habit learning. So we reuse now this building block that I mentioned earlier for habit learning. It's just reused here in this model. So that's the idea. Then we do the next level because we also want to make the second order level in it, second order self-model. Because remember the idea that of Garcia, that stress blocks regulation, blocks adaptation. So that means that the adaptation speed of this W is very low or almost zero due to your stress. So that's an extra problem, that this W has to be activated again. It has to, the speed of adaptation has to increase. And that's actually what is done by this model. So this model is that the speed of adaptation of this one is low because of the stress. And then by the therapy, you can get rid of that. And then the whole thing can unblock. So let's see how it works then. This is the second order self model for the stress blocks adaptation and persistence also in this case. And this is the first order self model that we already had. So these are the two things. So now we have a network model with three levels, and they are just relating to first order adaptation and second order adaptation, these two levels. So how do we run that? How do we simulate that? Well, I already told that we have a table format. If you do any simulation and you want to write about it, usually you have tables anyway, whatever type of modeling you do in a paper to make it reproducible, you have to specify your values, maybe only as appendices, but at least to get other people the opportunity to reproduce it, you need many values of your settings of your model. Well, this is just one specific form of standardized representation for it. So this is part, and these are the tables that we use for the connectivity characteristics. This shows which states, these are the states of this network example. And this shows which are the states that have direct causal effect on them. So for example, the PS is affected by the SRS state and also by the feeling state, the FS state. So that's what you can see here. So this just a qualitative type of indication, what are the arrows in the picture. This actually is just equivalent to the picture. This just specifies the arrows. But now, of course, you also need to wait. By the way, notice that I don't use the square matrix form where you would have 9 columns as well and a lot of empty places. This is just a more compact format. That makes it easier to specify it, and also some efficiency advantages. So then, for all of these the other nodes that have effect on these nodes that are considered, there you have the values. Now, one of these connection weights, of course, is not constant, because we have decided that the connection from the feeling state to the control state, that is this one, should be adaptive. Therefore, we cannot put a number here. Now, it's a very easy way of deciding that you say, no, it's not a number, but we know it is represented by this state. So just put the X7 name there. This is, in fact, similar to the old concept of pointers in programming. So you just don't write the number there, but you refer to where the number can be found. And that's actually how the software also works. Very, very simple, in fact. So that's how just this matrix format that can be used also for non-adaptive networks, then there are only numbers here, but it's very easy to extend the format for adaptive networks, just by adding these extra states and then putting references to them. So this is for speed factors. And remember that the speed of this adaptation there was also dynamic. So therefore we also refer to the H state, which represents that. So that's how it works. This is for the aggregation characteristics. This is the choice of combination functions. You can also choose more of them, then you get a weighted average. And these are the parameters of the functions. And you see that the persistence is also dynamic here, adaptive. So then we can see the simulation example here. You see that these are the base states. You see that there is a stressful stimulus here. This is the stressful feeling. You can see that it's high. And this is stress regulation that is not developed well. So that's the control state. And now the therapy comes in here. And then you see, due to the therapy, your regulation state comes up. And therefore, the stressful feeling goes down. So it works. But it should also work after the therapy. You don't want to be dependent on the therapy. So therefore we have these other states, how it works. So here we have initially there is no real learning because the speed is very low. The learning rate is very low due to the stress. But then by the therapy, the stress is taken away for a while. And then there is a learning rate boost. So now the learning rate becomes non-zero and becomes high. And therefore you see also that there is now some learning boost as well. And therefore we have now this, that this works also for the time after the therapy. You have also something with the persistence. And then let me go back. Then because of that, now you are strong enough. You've learned enough to regulate on your own without the therapy. So let's just finish it. I see the time is already passing by. I've shown that some network science ideas can be used to extend the causal modeling area with new possibilities so that they become better applicable. And let me see. Then there are many other things. I will just show them here. There are many possible extensions that still can be researched. It actually opens a new research area where you can still explore many things. For example, the higher order adaptive modeling is not so very common in the literature. You can many things you can explore that nobody has explored yet about it. So maybe because of the time, I have to keep it like this. Thank you for your attention.